more coming. I believe Andrea's next.
I'm here.
There she is.
I'm here. Great. Super cool. This is incredibly inspiring. And I want to thank you guys for including me in this evening. I love the talk so far. My name is Andrea Silverman. I'm an assistant professor here at NYU, and I have joint appointments here at NYU Tandon, where I'm in the Department of Civil and Urban Engineering, and also in the NYU College of Global Public Health. And a big reason why I have that joint appointment is because I'm an environmental engineer. And as environmental engineers, what we do is we like to take a multidisciplinary approach where we pull from the applied sciences and engineering, but we design interventions that protect the environment and then subsequently also protect public health, because of the important connection between the environment and health. Within the realm of environmental engineering, I work in wastewater treatment and water quality, and I realize that most of you don't get the privilege to talk about sewage on a Thursday night, and so we'll get to do that tonight. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about wastewater, a little bit about my work and the research we're doing in my lab, and as I go through, I'm also going to highlight some of the awesome women that are working in my lab, since we're celebrating women tonight. So first of all, wastewater. We all use a lot of water. We use water at home, we use water in the places where we work, and we use it for a lot of different uses. And all of that water, after we use it, it goes down the drain and it becomes wastewater. And because of the multitude of uses that we use water for, so in our sinks, in our bathtubs, dishwashers, washing machines, et cetera, there's a lot of different things that are in wastewater that we have to think about. The first thing that's in wastewater is water. We use a lot of water, so there's a lot of water in wastewater. The next thing that I like to say that's in wastewater are the things that we pour down the drain. So when you take a shower, the soaps and shampoo that you use, anything that's on your body, so lotions and gels that you wash up and go down the drain. Also everything that we have in our kitchen sinks, so food scraps, oils, et cetera. The next category that I like to bring up is the things that we ingest and then excrete in urine and feces. These include salts and nutrients from the food we eat, but also all of the pharmaceuticals, hormones, and other drugs that we take on a regular basis. A lot of them go straight through our bodies and out into wastewater. The next big class of things that are in wastewater are pathogens. So anytime one is sick, you're usually excreting high concentrations of pathogens, bacteria, viruses, protozoa, into wastewater. And these are really important things to think about, and it's the main focus that I have in my laboratory, because waterborne pathogens are still the third leading cause of global disease burden because of failures in treatment and disinfection. So with this, we flush our toilets, water goes down our drains. Where does it go? First of all, it goes to a sewer. From the sewer, and I'm going to give you guys a general sense of what happens in the United States. Things are a little bit different in other places. But in the United States, from the sewer, wastewater goes to a wastewater treatment plant. And that wastewater treatment plant, they do the best that they can to remove all the contaminants that I had mentioned. Not all of them is removed, but for the most part, we're meeting the EPA regulations to treat wastewater. I mentioned before there's a lot of water in wastewater, and that water doesn't just disappear. And so wastewater treatment plants will deposit that water into whatever nearby water source there is, so rivers, lakes, marine waters, estuaries, et cetera. One of the reasons why wastewater treatment is so important is because a lot of those environmental sources are sources of drinking water for another community. So water is often taken out of that same water body, brought to hopefully a drinking water treatment plant, and then brought to either the same community that had wastewater, or usually it's also a downstream community. So disinfection in both of these systems is incredibly important to try to stem the transmission of waterborne illness. And I have two students, my PhD student Monarusi and an undergraduate Nikki, who have been looking at disinfection in these conventional treatment systems, looking at things like chlorination and UV light. I'm not going to talk about those today. It's really cool projects, but what I'd like to focus on is the work that we're doing looking at disinfection in the natural environment. And the reason why we're focusing on disinfection in the natural environment is because there's a lot of wastewater globally that isn't treated. And the World Health Organization just put out an estimate that 85% of wastewater and human waste produced goes straight to the environment without treatment. So that means a lot of pathogens that are potentially in those water bodies that we want to prevent exposure to other people. So we like to think about, once those pathogens are in this natural environment, what happens to them? How long do they stick around? How long are they a health risk? The second reason why I like studying disinfection in the natural environment is because I'm interested in an alternative type of wastewater treatment facility. And these are natural treatment facilities. In particular, I'm going to talk about wastewater treatment ponds. And what these are, they're constructed ponds that have been designed specifically for wastewater treatment. They're used all over the world. We use them in the United States. They're used in Europe. They're used in Australia, New Zealand. They're also used in parts of the world with less resources available. They're used a lot in sub-Saharan Africa, Asia, Latin America. And the reason why they're beneficial is because they use a lot less resources. They're not as energy intensive. They don't need as much money for the construction and operation. I like to talk about these and just say that they are used everywhere. An example of them that I like to give is this wastewater treatment facility in Nairobi, Kenya. Nairobi is a big modern city, and its main wastewater treatment facility is a pond system, and it treats the waste of 1 million people. And as you can see, it does look like a natural pond system, but it has been specifically designed for this for wastewater treatment. This treatment facility works really well. I do want to say that there are some treatment facilities that haven't been designed as well. A lot of the design equations that have been put in place are black boxes. And so one of the things that we try to do in my research is better understand how disinfection happens in these systems so that we can enhance disinfection and design them to meet better treatment goals. So the main disinfectant in natural systems is sunlight. And so a big focus of our research is sunlight disinfection. The way that sunlight works is through two different mechanisms. There's the endogenous inactivation mechanism, where sunlight's absorbed directly by microorganisms. And that damage, that sunlight that is absorbed does direct damage and the organisms die. The second mechanism is an indirect and exogenous mechanism, where instead of being absorbed by the microorganism, the sunlight's absorbed what we call photosensitizer in the water column. And these tend to be organic matter, and after that sunlight's absorbed, this is a series of photochemical reactions that occur that create what we call reactive intermediates that are very damaging, and it's these reactive intermediates that then kill the microorganism. In approaching this work, we had a number of questions. What we really wanted to figure out was, for different organisms, what's the most important mechanism? How fast are these microorganisms dying? And how are they affected by water quality conditions? Because if we can figure all this out, we can better design these systems to make them do what we want in terms of disinfection efficiency. So in our lab, what we have is our workhorse is a solar simulator. It's a very big machine that makes fake sunlight. And having this machine helps us do controlled experiments where we don't have to worry about sunlight changing in intensity over the course of the day or over the course of the year. This machine has a solar spectrum that's very similar to what we see in the environment. What we tend to do with our experiments is we spike solutions with our organisms of concern, whether it's a bacteria or a virus, expose it to fake sunlight, and then we'll collect samples over time and look at decay. One example that I want to show you is work that we've done looking at disinfection of a human enteric virus. This is a virus that causes GI illness, things like diarrhea and vomiting, that afflicts a lot of people globally. When we expose this organism to sunlight, we see what we call log-linear decay. So if you look at the figure on the left, you should just notice that we're looking at the decay of this organism over time, and the steeper the curve, the faster that organism is dying. One of the tools that we have, and one of the things that we wanted to do, is to better understand how the spectrum of light impacts disinfection. So we took a filter, and we filter out certain parts of the spectrum. And what we find is that in this red curve, we have our modified solar spectrum without any of the short, most damaging wavelengths. And what we found is that when you expose a virus to those wavelengths, you have no inactivation at all, and it kind of flatlines. And so this tells us that these photons in here, even though it's just a small number, like it's a small percentage that we're losing, are absolutely important for disinfection. So we've done a lot of experiments like this, altering different parts of the solution chemistry, the environmental conditions, to figure out what the most important characteristics of an environment are for disinfection to happen with sunlight. And through all that, we've developed a model. I wanted to throw up the equation just to show you what's involved. Don't worry about it. K is our decay rate. So this is the equation that we can use to predict how fast our viruses and bacteria die in the environment. I just want to highlight that the inputs are easy to measure, And they're easy to measure. So we have the sunlight irradiance as an input, the light absorption of the water as an input, the water depth, and we also have an input that helps us figure out the number of photosensitizers for that indirect mechanism. We've had really good luck with this model. We validated it in a shallow pond in California, where we sampled over the course of a number of months. We collected viruses, we measured their inactivation rate, and we found, so in this figure, if you look at K, that's our decay rate. So the higher the value, the faster something's dying. In this case, a virus, our measured values are in the circles, our predicted values are in that black line, and we had excellent agreement between the two. And it's awesome, given that there's so much variability in natural systems. My PhD student, Wally, is now taking this a step further and also trying to understand what happens when you have algae in the water. Because a lot of algae blooms, if you guys have heard of them, it's one of these important kind of environmental concerns we have. Algae has an important impact, so she's working on figuring out that impact and will add additional terms to this equation. So I told you bacteria and viruses. One thing that we're doing, or a new project that we're working in our lab, is focusing on what we call an emerging microbial contaminant, which is DNA. And the reason why we're concerned about DNA is because DNA has the ability to confer antibiotic resistance to bacteria. And I don't know if any of you have been kind of paying attention to what's happening with antibiotic resistance, but we're finding that the number of antibiotic-resistant infections globally is increasing. And this is scary, because if you aren't able to therapeutically treat an infection, it could have fatal responses. There's definite interest from the World Health Organization, the CDC, and in my field, we're particularly concerned about this because there's a huge wastewater component to the potential transmission routes. If you are sick with an antibiotic-resistant infection, there's a good possibility that you're excreting through feces or urine very high concentrations of this organism. It then goes to a wastewater treatment plant. And at that wastewater treatment plant, we are hopefully chlorinating, so we're going to kill the bacteria. But the DNA within the organism is not touched at all by chlorine. It's really resistant. So what we find is that all of these resistance genes leave the wastewater treatment plant and go out into the environment. Colleagues of mine who have done surveillance for these antibiotic resistance genes have found them in a lot of environmental compartments in many different parts of the world. But one thing that we don't know is, are those genes still functional? How long are they going to stick around in the environment? And so that's where my lab comes in, and that's what we're working on right now. To just give you a brief sort of reminder of what DNA is, it's typically composed of two strands of nucleic acids. Those two strands are complementary paired to each other, and there's four bases that make up the DNA code. When sunlight or UV light impacts DNA, if you have two thymine bases next to each other and they absorb that light, they will bind together and form a thymine dimer. When that thymine dimer is formed, it forms this morphological change in the nucleic acid. And when that change happens, the cell can no longer read the DNA. So if the DNA encodes for resistance and you have this damage point, we like to say it's inactivated, that it won't work. So what we wanted to do is better understand what is the rate of this sunlight damage in these in different DNA codes. We've started out by looking at the Vana gene. It confers resistance to the antibiotic vancomycin. The Vana gene sits on this plasmid, which is a circular piece of DNA. And you can say it's just one. Vana is just right up here, one of those white arrows. It's just one piece, you know, one gene of many that make up this plasmid. Whenever you want to look for DNA in the environment, you have to decide what part of the DNA you're looking for. And so for my colleagues that are looking and doing surveillance, they've decided to use this target. So when they look for Vana in the environment, they look for this 65 base long target. But if you notice, if you look around at other parts of this code, and what I should have mentioned as well is this is the entire code of that Vana gene. If you look at other parts of that code, you see there's lots of places where there's two thymines next to each other. And so if we're only looking at this short segment, we may not actually be capturing the damage that's occurring to these dimers. So in addition to this short target, we're also looking at a longer target to capture more of the gene. And so two of my students, Fiona's a PhD student, and then Vongai, who's a NYU Abu Dhabi undergraduate student, have been working in my lab, and they have been taking this plasmid here, putting it in beakers, exposing it to simulated sunlight, and measuring the decay over time. And what we found, I'm going to first point out this maroon line. So this line here, where there's very little decay, is that short amplicon, that short target. And over 48 hours, we see very, very, very little decay. If you look instead at the blue line, this is our longer target. And what we can see is that we are capturing more of that damage by looking at more of the DNA. One thing that's missing here, though, is functionality. And so work that we're, you know, ongoing work in our lab is to figure out if we see this type of decay in the actual, like, is the gene there? Can we read it? What does that mean for decay of the whole gene? And could there potentially be decay on other parts of this plasmid that reduce function of the gene, even if we're not able to see it in our short targets? The second thing that I want to point out is that if we compare the decay rate, so we can use these curves to calculate, again, that rate of decay. And again, if you look at this figure, the taller the bar, the faster the decay. We see that our VAN-A gene, using that long amplicon, has a very, very small decay rate, especially if you compare it to MS2, which is a virus, and enterococci, which is a bacteria. This is concerning. And what this lets us know is that these genes persist in the environment for a very long time, even if exposed to sunlight. So ongoing work is that we're doing is to figure out what does that mean for function. I'm going to stop here. We have a lot of exciting work going on. It's all ongoing, and I hope I have an opportunity to share it with you in the future. But thank you for having me, and I'd love to take questions if any of you have them.